If you were to use just one word to describe Vince McMahon, insane would be it. If you were to use another, you'd think big. McMahon himself is an impressive physical specimen, a air quotes workout fiend, and even his grapefruit-sized balls are big figuratively, and you'd have to imagine literally, although definitely don't. Vince McMahon thought big when he reimagined pro wrestling as a glamorous worldwide enterprise of sports entertainment, insidiously purchasing the various North American wrestling territories to create one big national and subsequently international company. Most importantly though, Vince McMahon selected a big talisman to carry the whole thing across his tanned, rippling shoulders, Hulk Hogan. Vince knew that the ethnic regional stars of the old WWWF, the Italian-American Bruno Sammartino and the Puerto Rican Pedro Morales, were no longer fit for purpose. Vince instead went with Hogan, a living superhero with the moral compass to convince Middle America to fall for Vince's shiny and repurposed blood sport. Hogan modeled himself after the equally big superstar Billy Graham, using his own heroic charisma to become a big household name. His act was practically magic. Who else but Hogan, the very sight of whom inspired goosebumps, could get away with the hokey Hulk Up routine. This routine was a sensation and turned the regional WWWF into the big WWF, a national mainstream powerhouse. The underrated commercial run of the muscled macho man Randy Savage notwithstanding, it was Hogan who built that house. We do mock Vince for falling behind the times now, but he grasped the wider zeitgeist perfectly in the 1980s. The stars of the squared circle and silver screen alike were uber-inflated action heroes, the absolute pinnacle of what was perceived as masculinity. When Hogan attempted to join his spiritual brothers Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sly Stallone in Hollywood, McMahon thought big again when appointing his replacement. That man was the equally ripped Ultimate Warrior, a man who had muscles on top of muscles on top of muscles on top of problematic opinions. The man had muscles where his talent should have been. That, to McMahon, was enough. Warrior was a man so muscled, people thought he had died and been replaced by a doppelganger when he stopped, and it's safe to say this now, injecting himself with steroids. It was those same enhancements that spelled the end, albeit briefly, of the big man himself. The early 1990s scandal forced Vince into a rethink. Despite the fan-appointed Bret Hart earning raves for his work rate, Vince's desire for big went unfulfilled. Unable to push performers boasting these artificial physiques, Vince happened upon the idea of pushing, rotund gentlemen in their place. The girth giant that was Yokozuna and, let's face it, obese Mabel, occupied the headliner ranks throughout the new generation, at least until it became apparent that slow and tedious matches were, well, slow and tedious. Muscles were too risky, blubber was too boring, McMahon, with no other option, was forced to rely on height. But the very tall Diesel represented an all-time commercial low for the company throughout his 94-95 run as WWF champion. Diesel, at a build height of 6 foot 10 inches, failed to heighten the excitement of WWF fans, possibly because Vince stripped him of his badass aura and repositioned him as a smiling jackass. SummerSlam 95 was sold on the strength of tall versus fat, Diesel versus Mabel. Even with the business on its arse, McMahon played to an audience of one. You almost had to admire the man, at least until you watched the match. It was a big, big bust. Finally, it fell to Hart to carry the company. With the equally athletic, talented, and comparatively diminutive Shawn Michaels acting as a talisman throughout 96, it was a miracle that Vince didn't march them out to the ring on stilts. In the years that followed, the furore surrounding the steroid scandal dissipated. Slowly, the top stars of the WWF grew big once again. With the exception of Mick Foley, the Attitude Era headline acts were very, very defined. Though nobody was on trial and thus nobody testified, you would have to live in Hulk Hogan's own fantasy land to deny that the culture was back big time. As the popularity of the Attitude Era waned and the muscle monsters of the Ruthless Aggression Era quietly honed their skills in Ohio Valley Wrestling, McMahon was forced to settle for Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero. The two men were juiced to the gills, but that apparently still wasn't enough because they just weren't tall enough. But Brock Lesnar, John Cena, Batista, they were more like it, pal. For a brief time, McMahon reveled once again in big stars and big gates. The OVW star vehicle that was WrestleMania 21 became the biggest drawing pay-per-view ever for its time. But tragically, the events of the Benoit double murder-suicide in 2007 and the subsequent signature pharmacy scandal set in motion the definitive end of steroid use in WWE. Soon, and though not ideal for the macrophallic Vince McMahon, the idea of a WWE superstar changed forever. As the years rolled by, the smaller likes of CM Punk and Daniel Bryan represented Cena's only viable competition. The rise of the, air quotes, work rate era in parallel with the cleansing of the company converged to curb the physiques of the top acts. The shrunken but fiercely loyal WWE fanbase, naturally referred to as a universe by McMahon, grew to prefer big matches to big stars. In 2015, rumors circulated that Vince McMahon was going blind. Though these were thankfully quickly quashed, this might explain his affection for Jinder Mahal 2 years later. Selected for his heritage and insane vascularity, Vince must have done so through the process of braille reading. Unfortunately for Vince, who never changed, wrestling changed around him. The in-the-know fans resented and rejected the new WWE champion as a transparent attempt to venture into an emerging market, and as an unremarkable, by-the-numbers, plodder. The crowning of Mahal called into question both McMahon's decision-making and the integrity of the wellness policy introduced after Guerrero's death. How Mahal had arrived at a physique drier than an Alberto Del Rio promo is a mystery. Was it chicken? Was it broccoli? Was it a substance undetected by a wellness policy that visibly isn't big on being foolproof? Well, I eat two out of those three every single day, and well, look at me. We know with some certainty that the wellness policy is at least selective in its coverage. Vince's boy, Brock Lesnar, is certainly not immune to it. Lesnar is one spray tan away from representing McMahon's platonic ideal, which explains why he is positioned so ludicrously. Thankfully, the Lesnar loophole is not in effect elsewhere. Only Braun Strowman meets the traditional McMahon remit in 2018, and weirdly, his real boy, Roman Reigns, covers his chest, but stubbornness seems to have superseded big as Vince's default mentality. Vince McMahon's ideal body type is, and always was, big. Nowadays, though, the majority of the roster are no longer allowed to become big, which might explain why he seems to hate them so very much.
Wow, wasn't that great, guys? I don't know, it's your decision. Subscribe if you enjoyed it down here. Check out more of our content over here, or check out some of our other channels over here. Oh, you better click it before I do. No, seriously, you should click it though.